today we're doing a complete engine disassembly. In this case, it happens to be from a 73 240Z. If you've seen the previous films, essentially the car is 170,000 miles, but two of the cylinders have low compression. Turns out the piston rings need to be replaced. So we're doing a complete disassembly down to the block, remove the pistons, the rods. We'll ship the block out to a machine shop, clean it up, check for straightness, cracks, that sort of thing. Once it's back, we'll do a complete fresh rebuild. So that being said, if you have an L24, L26, or L28, those are the 240, 260, and 280Z motors. This will be a pretty good guide, or you know, something you can just watch and learn the different components. If you don't, nevertheless, we're glad to have you guys watching. And any questions, comments, leave it in the description box. And that being said, let's get to it. Now, a wonderful way to break loose old bolts, just use, of course, a wrench and a 3-pound hammer. That way, if you're not using impact tools or cordless tools, you're not going to kill your hands here. Now, as you remove bolts, just place them in a plastic bag and label the bag so you know exactly where the bolt belongs. Another wonderful thing is take a lot of pictures, because you may forget where certain things go. If you can take video, even better. Okay. And then we have a second bolt right down here. We'll just loosen up. Okay. So loosen this up just a little bit. And then we have one other bolt on the opposite end. Ooh, look how rusty this. This was really tough to get out. Look how rusted and just corroded this bolt is. Now we're going to remove the air pump here. Now before I remove the bottom bolt to get off this air pump, I just want to take note where the hosing is going. Okay, so the one toward me, this hose is bending up and it's coming to right up here to the plenum. Okay, and then the other one, this guy right back here, comes up to the air box. Okay, so now we'll remove the hosing and take the air pump off. Now, this happens often with these old and Phillips size clamps that they completely stripped away. So we'll have to find another technique to get this off. The other option is, because we're replacing these hoses, maybe I'll just cut them. Just make it easy. Might go crazy, right? On second thought, what I'm going to do is remove the hose from up top that connects to the plenum. And because it's high on top, in other words, it's not as much road grime and rust, so this one is coming off quite easy, or quite easily. The space is certainly confined in here, but it's so brittle, this hose, really should just cut the damn thing off and call it a day, but okay. And even with this other hose clamp, As you can see, it's just completely rusted, even with WD-40. Nothing's happening. I'm just going to cut the hose. Okay. So brittle. Okay. And there you go. And this is just a side bracket that was holding on that air pump. As you can see, these bolts are really tight, so 3-pound hammer. This thing is a lifesaver. And this was the bracket for the alternator. And this is the bottom alternator bracket. Sometimes there's just so much dirt and grit. You may have to search a little bit just to find any extra bolts here. Now we're going to remove the fan pulley bolts. Now, if you make the mistake of not loosening these bolts up before you take off the belt, because as you try to remove these, that one is loose, that one is loose, that one is loose. But here, as you can see, it's not loose and the pulley wants to spin. Just take a flathead so you can hold the pulley in place, okay? And just turn the bolt loose. There you go. Okay. So the next step is removing the fuel pump. We have two bolts on the bottom, little connection here, and it should slide right off. Now sometimes these fuel pumps can be a little touchy to remove. In other words, they can be really solidified on there. You really don't want to hit it with a hammer, especially if you plan on using it again. But what you could do is just find, let me get a screwdriver. Just find one part of, or a part of the housing where it protrudes out just a touch. So right here, there's a part of the housing that we can place a flathead, a Phillips head, doesn't matter. Place a screwdriver against the housing and then you can tap the end of the screwdriver with a hammer and it will come loose. Okay, this I was able just to wiggle off, so we're okay there. I did just spray down these clamps with WD-40. This one is already stripping out, but this one fortunately is coming loose. The other pretty interesting thing is if you take a look, there's a wrap. They have a wrapping around the fuel line. My guess is this must have been prone to vapor lock, and there's no other reason really that I could think of on why they would use this. So that's pretty interesting. I think this year 240Z had a problem with vapor lock, and I believe this was one of the solutions. So let's see if I can get this off now. Let's see what we got here. And sometimes these rubber hoses can really solidify on there.
Okay, so there's our fuel pump.
Now we're going to remove the spark plugs. The interesting thing here is the fact that these are quite large. These are 21 millimeter ends on the spark plug, so they're quite large. They're not your normal 5/8 drive spark plugs. So now we're going to remove this heating hose. I need to get access to this pressure switch, and it's just easier without this in the way. So just take note on how this is assembled. As you can see, it's really, this heats up the plenum, and this is all plugged off already. I did not do that, but nevertheless, just take note of the assembly. Take pictures, video, again, the best thing you can do. Okay. If I could remove this all as one unit, that would just make things very, very simple. As opposed to just having different parts all over the place. Okay. Now right here is the oil pressure switch. It would be easier if I removed the oil filter here. But to be honest, I'm trying to keep this area as clean as possible. In other words, once I remove this, some oil will come out. So this is fine. Okay. Now we're going to remove the air cleaning assembly and just slowly remove the carburetors, the linkages, so on and so forth. Now sometimes you'll find multiple vacuum lines going to spots that are very, very close to each other. Easiest thing you could do is just color code where everything is. So in this case, I have a yellowish green piece of tape for this guy. That matches up with this, blue to blue, okay? Make things as simple as possible. And then I'll put this hose right back on. Okay. So now we're going to remove the fuel lines, the air hosing, so on and so forth from the carbs. I was hoping to remove the fuel line here as one assembly. There's a bracket on the front of the motor. That's very easy to get to. You have a second bracket with a 10 millimeter bolt. I can't get to it. I can maybe get to it after some finagling, but there's a third bracket that goes underneath the plenum, so forget it. I was hoping just to clean this up in a sense, but it's just not going to happen. So we'll remove both fuel lines, the air hose, and then I'll reconnect this once it's off the vehicle. The carbs are off the vehicle. Looks like maybe a vacuum line there. Okay, and then we'll remove it from the engine. And I did spray WD-40 on both of these hose clamps. Okay.
The wonderful thing about carburetors is that the fuel system is not under pressure, meaning you do not have to release the fuel pressure on the vehicle, so you don't have to worry about gasoline or anything squirting on you. Okay. Okay. Wow. Okay. Now these are the two top mounting bolts on the carburetor furthest to the front of the engine. So we have the two top bolts removed. Both carburetors, as you can see, the bottom ones is just too tight. There's one right there. There you go. It's too tight for me to film it and for you to see what's going on. But essentially, there's two bottom ones on each carburetor. There's four bolts on each carb. Okay, right here. So I'll remove those two on each carburetor, and then we'll be able to pull this off, hopefully, as one complete unit. So all of the mounting bolts have been removed from both carburetors, and now I want to make sure everything comes off as one unit. So for example, there's a little diaphragm here. Instead of starting to disconnect the linkages and so forth, it's just a lot easier if I remove the two mounting bolts and just take everything off. The other thing to note is there's a metal line that runs to the top of the plenum. This has to be removed as well. Let me show you what this looks like. So at the rear of the carburetor, there's a metal line that runs up to the plenum. So I'm going to remove it from this location, and it looks very similar to the type of connection you find at master cylinders, on brake master cylinder. So I'm going to use a crescent wrench. If you compare that to your normal open-end wrench, you can see the big difference here. This would give a very, very good grip on this location. In other words, you don't have to worry about stripping it out. And then you have another problem to deal with. Okay. Boy, that gives a really, really good grip. Okay. There we go. Now it looks like we're ready to remove the balance tube, which is this component. As far as I could tell, we have two screws right here, two bolts, another two on the bottom, that should be okay. And then these connections, which one runs the exhaust manifold, and this is was plugged up anyway. This is looks like a water line. Okay. Whoa, that just cracked. Right down here. Everything's just so old and brittle on this car. Okay, I'm just going to leave it the way it is. Now looking at this, once we remove the balance tube, it looks like we probably could have removed the intake manifold with the balance tube on. The balance tube was right here. But this being the first time I've ever done a disassembly on a 240Z, I'm learning as I go. Plus it keeps the viewing a little bit easier for you guys. In other words, it's not as congested. So now we're just removing this fuel line assembly. And then the intake manifold will be right after this. And I'm just removing the bolts on the bottom here, which are for the exhaust manifold as well. On a quality standpoint, not one bolt has broken yet. I hope I don't jinx myself, but not one bolt yet. Really good quality, I tell you. I wish the same could be said about the rust prevention on these cars, but motor-wise, good stuff. So now we'll remove the exhaust manifold. There we go. Okay. Now in the bottom here, we have the crankshaft pulley, which is this guy, and the crankshaft bolt. Now interestingly enough, these can tend to be extremely tight to remove. What happened in this case is, in a previous video, we were showing how to remove flywheel bolts just using basic hand tools. And one of those techniques is holding down this crankshaft pulley bolt and then remove the flywheel bolts on the other side of the engine. And instead of the flywheel bolts breaking loose, this crank bolt broke loose instead. So this is already loose for us. Now, if you're not using impact gun or you don't have an impact gun, air tools, cordless tools, nothing like that, what you can do, or really what you need, is a breaker bar. A breaker bar. This is a breaker bar, okay? An absolute lifesaver. This is actually Harbor Freight. This is surprisingly very, very good. I use this thing all the time. I would say it's roughly 18 inches long, so you need that leverage, and then put a pipe over the end of this, give you that big time leverage to crank these bolts loose. But in this case, we're okay. And then usually you need a puller, but this is coming right off. Again, if it's not sliding off, you need a puller to get out this or take off the crank pulley. Okay.
Now just make sure you have a drain pan, because when you remove this, the coolant will come out. Now if you notice, this should be green. And what happened here is either a head gasket went, or maybe with a cracked head, who knows? At this point, we're not sure, but this is not what we want to see. This is oil and coolant mixed together. So obviously needs a rebuild, without a doubt. Now we're going to remove the rocker cover that sits on top of the cylinder head. And then right over here, we have the thermostat housing. Now in this case, we have to drill out both stems because the head of the bolt snapped off and the stem is still in the housing on both ends. So in this case, we're using a titanium bit. These things are great for just chewing up aluminum or really just any type of bolt they have on your engine. It does a very, very good job at just cutting that away. So now we need to remove the camshaft sprocket. Now you might have seen this on Wheeler Dealers when Ed was reprofiling the camshaft, but let's say you're doing this job and you're not doing a complete disassembly, you're just removing the head, or again, you're doing putting in a new cam, whatever the case may be. If you want to set the timing so nothing gets messed up, essentially, what you need to do is rotate this sprocket. This is an 18 millimeter. You rotate it until the number one marks up with the highlighted link. So this link here is brighter than the other ones. So you rotate it until number one marks up, and then right over here, there's a marking, and I'll move the screwdriver in a second. There's a marking on the sprocket that corresponds with another marking behind it. And what you need to make sure, let me show you, is that V marks up with that little line. It's very, very small. So I get right here. You see a little marking right there? And then you have the V. Make sure that lines up, okay? Once you do that, then you can go ahead and remove the sprocket. Now lastly, there's a tool. It's well worth it. It's around $12 on Amazon. And what you need, I'll take it out. You need this tool. You place it into the engine, or this marking section of the engine. That way, when you take off the sprocket, the chain won't collapse because there's a tensioner right here. So you grab this tool, worth every penny. Place it in here, like so. Okay, and that's it. So let's go ahead and remove the sprocket. Okay, and there you go, there's your cam sprocket. So now we need to remove the cylinder head from the vehicle, or the engine in this case, I should say. Now, this does not have your normal hex nut bolt. This is actually a Torx bit. It's a T55 Torx bit, that's the size that you need. And the other thing to note is when you remove this, do it in a crisscross fashion, okay? Now, because we're not using cordless tools or impact tools, use a breaker bar. Makes the job much, much easier. So now they're all loose. I'm just going to remove them and we'll pop the head right off. Look how long these suckers are.
Now, as you remove the bolts here for the cylinder head, just take note, if you are doing this on a 240Z, that the lengths are different. Now, this is a late Z motor, meaning this is a 73. On the earlier ones, 70, maybe 71, they had three types of lengths regarding the head bolts. So just take note where they, where you remove each bolt and mark it accordingly. So in this case, if you are using a, or you're doing this on a late model Z, and you only have two lengths, the long bolts, okay, so this guy, this is the longest one, goes in number one. This is the passenger side, this is where the distributor was. So just in case if you got lost, long bolt goes here, number four, six, and seven, okay? So just take note of that. Again, if you're doing this on a 240Z, number one, number two, third one is short, four is long, short, long. Other side are all short bolts, okay? Now before we pull this cylinder head, I just want to make sure I don't see any bolts left over. It looks like there's one bolt here. There's another one on the opposite end. As far as I can tell, that's attached to the cylinder head, so we need to remove this as well. It looks like a 10 millimeter. Okay, here we go. Trying to find a good place to grip this. All right. It's heavy, holy moly, it's heavy. Oops. Okay. So now we're going to invert the engine, meaning we'll rotate it 180 degrees, take off the oil pan, and start with the bottom end of the engine. One thing to note, it's going to make a mess, so have cat litter ready, oil pan, drain pan, that sort of thing, just so you're ready to clean up everything. The other thing you could do is plug up where the dipstick goes. So, because if you have any leftover oil and so forth, that will leak out. If you want to plug it, go ahead and plug it. The other thing is, if you do have a blown head gasket or a cracked cylinder head, the aroma is really, really strong. It's actually pretty stinky. So if you're doing this in a garage, open up the garage door, because when oil and coolant mix, it's just a nasty stench. So now we'll go ahead and remove the oil pan. As you can see, there's a number of 10 millimeter bolts. I've never actually seen an oil pan with so many bolts on it. Wow. But nevertheless, 10 millimeter, and then we'll take off the oil pan. And we'll now remove the oil strainer. And now we'll remove the front cover to the engine.
We'll just remove the tool here. Okay. Here's your timing chain. Now attaching to the end of the crankshaft, you have the oil thrower. This is a worm gear, therefore lucky. Yeah, that's pretty much it. So sometimes you can slide off the worm gears. In this case, I'll use a puller. And then right here is a crankshaft or the crankshaft sprocket. For this, for sure, you will need a puller. Now, if you don't have a puller, you can rent one from your local auto parts store. But obviously, we need to remove these two items before we start taking apart the pistons and the connecting rods. Now, your best bet is to reinstall the crankshaft bolt before you use the puller. Let me zoom out here so you can see this. Now, in this case, the crankshaft bolt, I already have it boxed up in a shed. So, a lot of times these sets give you a lot of different attachments. So, I'm going to use this attachment. We'll place this over. The worm gear. As you can see, let me zoom in here. There you go. Okay, so now let's do the sprocket. So I'm just grabbing another bolt I found in the garage here, and then you take the tool and just place it, if you can, place it over the second set of the sprockets. In other words, don't put it here, just in case, because you don't want to nick anything. Okay, so try to get it behind this guy. And then make sure it's all clamped on there, and as you can see, it's already moving out. Let me zoom out here so you can see this. Let me get a wrench. And here we go. And as you can see, it does this very, very easily. There's no effort in this whatsoever. There we go. So now we're ready to remove the pistons and the connecting rods. And as you remove each one, just keep everything in order. So cylinder 1, 2, 3, all the way to 6, okay? So let me show you on how we'll do this. We'll need a breaker bar just to break loose all the connecting bolts, and then we can easily get everything out. Now these will be rather tight. Again, I'm just using a breaker bar just to break them loose, okay? Okay.
Now on the opposite end, we have the bearing. It's starting to scorp a little bit. And of course, we will install brand new bearings when we rebuild this. There we go. Okay. Now what you want to do is keep everything in order. So this happens to be the number one piston and connecting rod. If you do get lost, marked on the connecting rod, as you can see, is number one, indicating the number one connecting rod and piston. So what we'll continue to do is remove number two all the way through six, line everything up, keep everything in order, and then we'll move over to the main caps and remove the crankshaft from the engine. Now the 240Z is a very, very well balanced motor, and that's because one main feature is that the crankshaft has a 7 main bearing design. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now these happen to be 17 millimeter bolts. I'm going to break them again with a breaker bar. Again, the center and the rear will need a puller to make the job easier. And if you do get somehow mixed up on which direction these face on the stamped on top of each main cap is an arrow pointing toward the front. Okay, so this is where the crank, again, crank pulley is here. Back here is your flywheel, okay? Now I just overlooked that number three main cap, but as I place everything on the bench, everything now is in order. So if you make that mistake, don't worry about it. Just make sure when you place everything on your bench, It's lined up from 1 through 7 in this case, or 7 to 1, however you want to line it up.
So a little bit of good news, bad news situation. The bad news is I don't have a puller that's going to work here so we can pull the, in this case, the center and the rear main cap. The good news is maybe we can get around it. And what I'm trying here is, chances are, obviously, if you're doing this kind of work, you probably have an engine crane. So what I'm thinking is very, very carefully line up the engine crane with, this is the rear main cap, let me turn on the light here, with the rear main cap, and this is the center. Now as you can see, they're threaded. These two main caps are threaded. So what I've done is I went to Home Depot. This happens to be an M8 size bolt. And the grade is grade 8 on the bolt. Grade 8 means the tensile strength is very, very good. Tensile strength essentially means how much force this bolt can take before it snaps. So what my idea is, we'll thread this down with the chain attached and then try to crank the engine crane here, the hydraulic pump, and hopefully this will snag out. The other way, another option I'm thinking about if this doesn't work is maybe place a piece of wood here, use a bolt with a thick washer, and then use a pry bar to kind of get it out. But I think this is going to work. I think this will work pretty well. So let's give it a shot. So M8 size bolt, and these are M10 washers. So I grabbed two bolts. It was in a package of two bolts with the washers. It was maybe like $3. Now, if you're not sure on the size of bolt that you need, what I did, as you can see here, I have one of these, my other one broke, I just picked up another one, but I had a spare bolt that did fit into that main cap, but it was way too short, and I just lined it up with this. These are great to have. This, maybe $3 to $3.50. So I just lined up with this marking on it, and I knew exactly the size that I needed. The other option is, if you can find any bolt to fit in that cap, when you bring it to Home Depot, Lowe's, they have a stamped piece of steel with a bunch of different sizes, ranging from, it could be M4, M6, M8, all the way up to a high number, M20, and then you just find the right bolt size and you know what size you're looking at. So let's go ahead and carefully set this up and let's see if it works. So what I'm going to do is first lower this very, very carefully. You don't want to score up any of the bearings on the crankshaft, obviously. So very, very carefully, we'll lower this. Just take your time, don't rush it. Okay. Now, going to grab the bolt with the washers. Don't forget the washers. And I'll come in for another shot in a moment before we pull this so you can see exactly what we're working with here. A little bit more. Okay. And I'll thread it into the rear cap here. Okay, so it's nice and tight. Now we're just going to lift this up. Okay. Okay, so now there's some tension on there. Take a mallet. This is lightly. Okay, safety goggles, you never know what could happen here. So again with the mallet, you see it's moving already? Okay, maybe a little bit more, try to get centered again. And there you go, that's it, so it worked. So again, for sure you can do this, as you can see. Just be extremely careful, make sure you line everything up, try to get a complete straight plane. Regarding this, maybe like a 90 degree angle, okay, completely flat and level as possible.
And there you go. You don't have to go crazy about renting a puller, nothing like that. Okay, now let's try the center cap. Now, if you're curious, if anything got scored up, let me move. There we go. Everything looks to be in very good shape. No markings, no scoring up. So again, if you're really careful, you should be perfectly fine. Let me grab the cap. Here's the cap. As you can see, the bearings starting to wear down. I can't fit my fingernail in there, so we're okay in that sense. But so just be really careful, and I think you'd be okay.
All right. Let me grab a mallet. Just lightly tap it. I'm going the red. Okay. Let me do it from the other side here. Let me go around. Just take your time. You know, that's all I can say. Just take your time. Don't rush this. Okay. All right. Here we go. Bring it up a little bit. Don't forget your safety goggles, by the way. Okay. A little bit more. A little bit more. There we go. All right. We turned out to be in good shape. Right here is where the center cap was. No markings. And then where the rear cap was. Again, everything is in good shape. The caps are in good shape. Now back here, this is the rear main oil seal. Of course, we'll use a new one. Okay, throw that in the garbage. And now we'll lift the crankshaft out of the block. Now, if you're curious on the condition of these main cap bearings, they certainly, it's time for a rebuild. Not horrible, but certainly I can't fit my fingernail in here, which is good, but they're starting to wear down for sure. So, very good time for a rebuild.
So that's what's involved if you do want to disassemble an engine. The key thing is take a lot of pictures, a lot of video. Even what you just saw, I took additional video just showing exactly where certain hosings went, vacuum hosings, things for the carburetor linkages. Just take a lot of video and pictures. The best thing in the world. Even with shop manuals, they will list vacuum diagrams and things like that, but it can be pretty confusing if you're not sure what you're looking at. So video, pictures, best thing in the world. Next step for this engine is it will be going to a machine shop, meaning they'll check for straightness, flatness, they'll clean it up, make sure everything is in good running order. Same with the cylinder head. That's not my expertise. I don't have the tools here. Even with the pistons, I don't know what we're going to do actually with the pistons. I mean, for sure we'll have new rings, but scratch that. Don't worry about that. Once everything is back, I'll go over in detail what was done. So hopefully you've enjoyed this. If you like this stuff, please subscribe. We will continue to work on the 240Z. And it still needs a lot of work. The chassis working needs a lot of rust, brakes, things like that. So we'll keep on adding to the list on the 240Z here. And until then, thank you for watching.